Mr. Rajiv Malhotra. Sir, just a few days ago, I got a call. I got a telephone call saying that Arun Chaudhary ji se baat karni hai. Already, main Rajiv Malhotra bol raha. So I said, how can I recognize you? You have to say, I am the Rajiv Malhotra speaking. So also in this month, Rajiv has given us a pair of spectacles, a new pair of spectacles through which to understand, through which to see our own religion and our own tradition. He has done this with meticulous scholarship and with as much force. He has smashed the distorted lenses which were fabricated by so-called scholars abroad and here, and through which, to our shame, we have been seeing our religion and our tradition. So it is a dual contribution that he has made. And it is, of course, the book is full of facts. The book is full of documentation. But even more so, it is suffused with very important argumentation. It is not citation mongering, just quotations from here and there, or just alleging conspiracy theories. It is an argument that he gives us as to why it is that certain propositions which you and I may have taken innocently as just the finding of a scholar, why that proposition is being advanced. For instance, why is it that the church is afraid of the notion of immanence? Most of us would not have thought about it. But he gives us a deep reason as to why this is the case. Second is his plain speaking. Because many scholars say things in such a convoluted way. Very often they say it in such a soft way because they are still looking for careers or acclaim in the very circles that need to be exposed. Rajiv told me that his attitude in these matters was that what we do must be, as he to use his word, unignorable. It's a wonderful word. But that does not mean abuse. That does not mean just a sort of torrent of strong words. It means the kind of scholarship and documentation which he has provided. And third point about him before I get to the book is why he is an example to us, that he is truly independent. He is not dependent on any institution. He is not dependent for acclaim from an audience. So that true independence of an individual scholar is an example which we should always bear in mind, because too often in India I found, as I had occasion to mention here earlier on this very thing, last time you were kind enough to call me, too many of us look for institutional perches from which to do some work. But the great work that has been done by individual scholars working absolutely alone and unaided, often unrecognized. On both sides, if you see Kaushambi's work on one side, or if you see Kale's work on the other side. So we should take heart and follow the example of a person like him who, laboring alone, I know from scholars in the West that they are apprehensive if he walks into a room in a conference on philosophy or religion or on Indic studies in the West. So, sir, now this book shows how tendentious this scholarship has been. Mr. Doval was just recounting some of these things, but really he, if I may use a word, he shows that these scholars were really, had really been sort of missionaries in Murti, and how they have been insinuating certain notions in us, so sowing the seed of that tree which will keep changing, but their tree also keeps changing in this way. And he documents the lengths to which they will go. If I may just read one passage, one of the chapters is devoted to a very famous scholar from whom, who was very well cited in India by Indian scholars, Paul Hacker. And Rajiv tells us that when his collected writings were being published to mark his 65th birthday, these were mostly, many of the writings about India, Indian religion, Hinduism, and so on. And I'm quoting, he says that, acting on Hacker's wishes, the editor of his collected works excluded the author's polemical Christian writings from the compilation. I found the same thing in the case of Max Müller. If we see the four volumes of his letters, in fact, sparks from Smithies, something. Those writings are just not known in India, but they set out a clear agenda of, and their hope in Brahmo Samaj as to how it will be the lever by which India will be converted. So, and their great disappointment when the very person on whom they were relying, uski wo Ramakrishna ji ke paas jata hai aur Ramakrishna ji uski ajamda kar dete hai aur wo unka murid ban jata hai. So, Rajiv documents their tendentious scholarship and the lengths to which they will go. He documents so well the echo effect that they create. Wo kuch likhenge, yahan quote hoga, kyunki ab Indians bhi wohi keh rahe hain, ya Hindu scholars bhi wohi keh rahe hain, to wo bhi Hindu scholars ko quote karkar apni cheez ko aur bhi reinforce kar lete hain. And much of it turns on definitions. They will define a religion as something and thereby say, as Dovel was reminding us, no, Hinduism is not a religion. Because the central authority is not, book is not, prophet is not. But our khasiyat is not that it is not. You see, as he writes, Kumbh Mela hai. Kisne start kiya hai? Kaun uske piche hota hai? Magar, patne kitne 3 crore log aajate hai? 10 crore. Sabarmalai mein, Sabarmalai mein, patne 3 million go. Or these Kavadiyas. Nobody knows who has started the yatra. Nobody knows who organizes it. And yet it continues and nobody has been able to erase it. Now, for somebody, if you define a religion as one that must have a central authority, director, an authority to which a sort of supreme court which can pronounce something is right or not right, then you say this is not a religion. But then you are surprised that it continues. So you know, but then you have to say, well, no, but it doesn't. It does not continue with it, is not there, it is something new which is being created. This used to be the same thing till even the 1970s, that India is actually not a nation. The nation was also being defined in the same way, that which is one race or one language or one religion or a contiguous territory. And it turned out that none of those things held for many other countries at all. So, Rajiv does this. They cannot comprehend, and if I quote a Western scholar whom Rajiv knows so well and about whom also I'm sure he would have helped me to educate us with, but Diane Eck, in her wonderful work on pilgrimage in India, she uses a sentence which is incomprehensible to many of the scholars. She says that India has been defined not by the writs and edicts of their kings, of its kings, but by the footfalls of its pilgrims. This year India was never united. Itne kingdoms the, But have you ever heard of a pilgrim's procession being stopped at any border within India? And those who are inside the tradition, Gandhiji, Ramakrishna Paramahansa, you can't even think that someone will ask such a question. But Gandhiji, Vinoba, unko, for those who are steeped in the tradition, Vivekananda, they could see the essential unity. And it is just the outsider who sees only the difference. And in this, Rajiv so well documents their double standards. You see, among, there are animosities among Christian sects. The Shias and Sunnis are killing each other. But Christianity remains a religion. Islam remains a religion. When there is a difference of opinion on things which are essentially unknowable, say between different sampradayas or between a ritual, they say, dekha ji, ek religion nahi. Acha, ek taraf hai ki ek religion nahi hai. There is nothing like Hinduism. Magar, agar ek inscription aapko mil gayi jisme ki aap infer kar sakte ho, jo inscription mein nahi likha hai, ki bhi kisi ne, kisi local sect ne, kisi local Jain temple ko appropriate kar liya, to aap kehte, dekha ji, Hindu. Hinduism is so intolerant, it took away the temples of the Jain. A religion which did not exist till just now. I have documented this in the case of many of these Marxist systems. Similarly, Rajiv so correctly points out this whole notion that of boundaries between religions, that these in our case are permeable. I mentioned here an example from a survey in Japan, 1985. Yes. And Ian Ryder has a book on this. People were asked, what is your religion? So 95% of them said, we are Shinto. 76% of them said, we are Buddhist. It couldn't be, but because it was no different for them, it was a completely Judaic, Christian, Islamic notion that you can either belong to this or to that. We are Hindus, many of us, persons like me, all my reading is Buddhist, many of my practices would be from the teachings of the Buddha, but nobody will say that I am less of a Hindu or more of a Buddhist or vice versa. And actually this notion was fomented in India, and it is the first time this happened is in the Shiromani Gurdwara Prabandhak Committee Act. In that act, who is a Sikh is defined. Who is a Sikh? He who believes in the Granth Sahib. He who believes in the 10 Gurus. Most of us would be Sikhs from that point of view. Therefore, a new clause was added, and who does not belong to any other religion. And Rajiv showed, now you and I may think it is just an administrative thing. But that seed is sown in 1925, and you see it in the agitations of Bhindranwale and others much later. As to what happens when these seeds come into being. And as Dobal was just saying, one of the essential things about that scholarship was that, and Rajiv does a wonderful job of documenting this, that we cannot do anything right. You see, if we remain as we were, let us say we keep sacrificing animals, then we are fossilized. Hinduism is uncreative. If people come along and say, no, sacrifice does not mean sacrifice of animals, it does not even mean sacrifice of your material assets alone, it means the sacrifice of your ego. That's it, Gandhiji's Anashakti Yoga. Look at it. Hey, name of Hinduism. This was never there. And as Rajiv points out, that every Christian theologian has actually been inventing a neo-Christianity, but nobody says that. So if Vivekananda reformulates things so that it is relevant to the times, then he's just inventing. If they do something, it is creative, it is renaissance, it is reformation. दो बस आप बुरा नहीं मानेंगे, हमारे सीनियर लोग हैं वो ये बुरा नहीं मानेंगे, मुझे एक तरह बिहारी दोस्त ने मुझे एक मुहावरा उनका बताया, वो कहते थे वो करे तो चमत्कार, हम करें तो बलत्कार। ये जो चीज है नॉट ओनली दैट, इफ you see, there are contemporary accounts. I mean, we have one of the best people I know, knowledgeable on Islam and Islamic history, or the rule, history of Islamic rule in Arifia. Islamic historians, contemporary historians, court historians, writing accounts contemporary with the events, are full of slaughter, of destruction of temples, and so on. So how is that to be explained? The word that has been used, I was quite surprised. They said that this proves that this was not being done. The accounts claiming that all this has been done by our great king is because he was not doing it. Why then did you write it? Because they were trying to claim verbal virtue for him. But if that one inscription shows that after losing a wager, the Jains had to vacate a particular temple for the Shaivite, local Shaivites, then it is Hinduism is intolerant. And the ridiculous lengths to which people will go, Rajiv documents this, that in Swami Vivekananda's case, in the case of others, when they make anubhav, direct personal experience, as the criterion or as the mode, then that we are only trying to ape the West and ape Western science. Well, he asks, was Patanjali aping Western science or West? Was Ramakrishna Paramahansa aping the West or Western science or Raman Maharishi? In every one of these things, I could go on with it. It's a book which is a must for every Indian. We must see our tradition through the spectacles that persons, and especially Rajiv Malhotra, has constructed for us. And it was a particular education for me, because I always had focused only on these Marxist historians and felt that they were regurgitating, sort of swallowing and vomiting what had been written by some Soviet historians. But I then now realized, after reading Rajiv's book, that actually they were swallowing and vomiting what many of these so-called Western scholars in America and in Austria or Germany had written, with a purpose and agenda. Sir, the main lessons from this book, I spell out three, and that I'll sit down after that. One is, there is reason we should look to the future with confidence. Even in the religious sphere. Because in the case of Christianity, Raji points out, attendance is falling by the hour, not even by the day. In places like Belgium, it has almost completely disappeared, attendance in churches. Islam is tearing the Muslim world apart. And even more important, it's a very important and point of great insight which Rajiv has made, that of the religions, Hinduism and Buddhism, the Indic religions, are the closest to the spirit and substance of science. Just as the goal of science is the understanding of outer reality, its method is experimentation and peer review, its means is the laboratory, so also Indic religions are the science of the inner world. Their means is personal direct experience. And their peer review is unending. That is how the review keeps evolving. And its method is entirely the scientific method of empirical verification through direct personal experience. And the means, just as the means for those persons are laboratories and observations through instruments. Here, a very good phrase Rajiv uses, that the means, our words, the living laboratories of these sages. They looked inside their own minds and came up with great formulations and great insights. So time is on our side, and we should do, and we should work on these matters and practice our religion with great confidence. If something requires reformulation, we should reformulate it and say, yes, we have reformulated it. Because this is the new formulation, is what is required by the times. If we need to endow old words with new meanings, we should do that with confidence. We must have, and I'm sure you will have after reading Rajiv's book, a little contempt for these tendentious scholars. Then मुझे याद है कि यहाँ तमिलनी ऑडिटोरियम में एक म्यूजिक फेस्टिवल चल रहा तो सिद्धेश्वरी देवी जी गाने के लिए बैठी थी तानपुरा की ट्यून हो रहा था तबला ट्यून हो रहा है लाइट डिम हो गई somebody got up in the audience and सिद्धेश्वरी देवी जी She sang what she had planned to sing. खत्म हो गया लोगों ने बहुत तालियां बजाई अब वो दूसरे गाने के लिए ट्यून हो रही है लाइट फिर से डिम हो गई वही शख्स फिर से उठा वो तो बहुत अच्छा था अब ये गाइए She again sang what she wanted to sing. The third time he got up. Then Sudeshwari Devi, yeah, अरे ये है कौन तो हमें ये एटीट्यूड होना चाहिए ये है कौन एंड द मेन थिंग टू डू इज टू सक्सीड इवन इन इंटेलेक्चुअल थिंग्स नथिंग सक्सीड्स लाइक सक्सेस नॉट वन ऑफ दीज स्कॉलर्स विल फैब्रिकेट एंड प्रोपोगेट द टाइप ऑफ नॉनसेंस that he does about India, he will never do it about China.
Yes.
Because China has become strong. And the scholars know that if they write things about China, they will lose their livelihood because they will lose their access to their sources. So the important thing is to succeed and then everything will follow. And one reason, final reason for being confident is that because of the work of Ram Swarup, Sitaram Goyal, Conrad Elst, David Frawley, Rajiv Malhotra, because of the work of these persons, the corpus is now reaching a critical mass. So that we can think that in a few years we will have two series. One, a library for India and a library of India. We should aim for those. But the prerequisite is that we should be like Rajiv Malhotra, we should know our tradition, we should know our religion. The reason on account of which this kind of fabrication has prevailed for so long is that we have not known our tradition, not known our religion, and we have known these only through the eyes, we have seen these only through the distorted lenses which were fabricated by these tendentious scholars, these missionaries in Mufti. So Rajiv, on certainly on my behalf, and I'm sure on the behalf of everyone, and on behalf of all your readers, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It was, as expected, a very good initiation of the whole concept and the idea under the book.
He very rightly said that the future is right. Everything you are, whatever you do, whatever your arguments are, whatever facts are right, so much you do. If you have got the requisite energy and the strength to back up, then probably you are never wrong. And we have got to make a work for in making the evidence very strong. But there is something extremely important point, I think, before it gets missed, we should underline it. There is a great intellectual conspiracy. That is, you first define. You first delineate the framework and put the paradigm in place, and then you start judging everyone by the yardstick. Now, this measuring tape, which is decided by others to suit them, and then measure our length and length on the basis of that, is something that we have got to be extremely careful. Now, he mentioned about the SGPC's Act that came in the 20s. And how this phrase that is anyone who does not belong to, who doesn't belong to any other religion. The origin of it was that all Sikh Gurdwaras were actually being run and managed by the Mahants, who were Hindu Pandits. And Sikhs never objected to it right from the time the Gobind Singh was established, and the Khalsa Panth, and thereafter the Gurdwaras started coming. So all the rituals, all the management, everything was in the hands of the Hindus. It was only after the LGBTC Act came that is, an effort was made to see how you can disintegrate the cultural unity, the organic code of the Hindu system. But thank you very much, and thank you for your very, very profound observations.